The way to deploy hardening settings is through golden images. Your goal with patching is to deploy 99% of the required patches fully automatically. On the technical side, central identity management is the way to go. Because the main goal of vulnerability management is not to manage vulnerabilities. Most backup systems that we come across are not actually ransomware resistant. Hi, this is Carsten from Hacking Matters, where each week we discuss the challenges in cybersecurity. Today we look at five baseline processes that should be the foundation of any security program, namely patching, hardening, identity management, vulnerability management, and backup and recovery. Before diving into these five baseline processes, let's remind ourselves what factors get companies hacked. Virtually all cybersecurity incidents come down to six factors: missing patches, insecure configuration settings, weak or shared credentials, ineffective backup and recovery, susceptibility to social engineering, and ineffective monitoring. The first four of these factors can be addressed with the five baseline processes. Why five and not four processes, we'll understand in a moment. The remaining two factors are more advanced topics to address and require a skill ramp up in addition to processes. Coming back to the five baseline processes, the first is patching. Your goal with patching is to deploy 99% of the required patches fully automatically. For the remaining 1%, you want emergency patching procedures that you can activate as a hacking wave sweeps through the internet. So how do you best introduce patching? You're not going to start by deploying all patches fully automatically from day one. Instead, you're going to deploy a task force to focus on one technology at a time and really understand well how that technology can be patched and what test procedures have to be put in place to see whether the patches broke anything. Chances are none of these test procedures will ever tell you that patches broke your applications, but you need that learning curve to appease everybody else in your organization, because there are scars from the past where patches did break applications, and we have to build bridges to other technology stakeholders to signal to them that, unlike in the past, today security patches do not break production anymore. The way to get started on patching then is to put together a small task force of 3 to 4 people who look at one technology at a time, implement a few test procedures to check whether anything broke in production, and then usually in a night shift, deploy all patches in that technology and run the test procedures, ready to roll back any patches should it become necessary. You do this one technology at a time until you have built enough confidence to switch over to fully automated patching, probably on a monthly schedule. Do not forget to plan for reboot cycles for those monthly patches, of course, so there will be production impact. And for your most critical applications, you need redundant environments anyway, where you can reboot one site while the other is taking over the load. This patching task force, whose main job is to build confidence around patching, will have to focus on both OS level patching and middleware patching. And middleware patching usually is a lot more work in understanding the technology and how to best patch it. When we got ready to launch Jio, a big digital ecosystem in India, we had about 17,000 servers that we wanted to move into an automated patching schedule. The patching task force that we put in place could, in one night shift, patch every single Windows server, because Windows OS patches are highly, highly automatable, and it's very easy to run test procedures. The same task force could tackle 500 Linux servers in one night, so much less than Windows, because test procedures are a little bit more cumbersome on Linux. And that same task force in a single night shift could only patch 2 Oracle server instances. Oracle database patching is a lot more work and involves many more manual steps, and moving that into automation is more work. So do budget enough time to cover all your middleware technologies as you're rolling out automated patching. Second baseline process, hardening, basically setting configuration settings to secure levels. Oftentimes, these configuration settings are a lot more impactful than patches, because chances are if you get it wrong in one place, you got it wrong in all of the places. And if you got it wrong at one time, unless you realize the mistake, it'll stay wrong forever. The way to deploy hardening settings is through golden images. That is, to have a master copy of each of your operating systems that includes all security best practice settings, and have the security team be involved in maintaining that golden image so that each time somebody starts a new server instance or virtual machine or Docker instance, it's pulled from that golden image or from the Docker Artifactory with all the security settings already enabled. A golden image is not going to solve all your configuration concerns, since you will deploy middleware and applications on each server instance, and hence you need individual configuration settings for each of them. The easiest way to find whatever settings are missing is through vulnerability scans. And we'll talk about vulnerability management in a moment as the quality assurance on hardening. Hardening then becomes two parallel sub-processes. On the OS level, you set all the recommended settings in a golden image, and you encourage everybody to use those golden images when building new servers. On a middleware and application level, you rely on vulnerability management to point in the right direction, to point out which technologies are not hardened yet. For both of those, OS level and middleware, you can rely on CIS benchmark. The Center for Internet Security publishes lists of recommended settings. Often, you won't be able to implement every single one of these settings, but again, trust vulnerability management to point out any gaps should they remain. Third baseline process, identity management. Here, your main goal is to have all identities centrally managed. So to avoid dangling accounts with insecure passwords that have long been forgotten, but then can be hacked. Moving Windows servers, as an example, under central identity management is easy. You just add the servers to Active Directory and make sure no local admin accounts exist anymore. Similar aggregation points exist for other operating systems. Red Hat has one, as do other OS vendors. And on the middleware and application layer, you want to rely on single sign-on as much as possible. So to leverage an existing, for instance, Active Directory identity to log into those applications as well. But this will still leave gaps, mostly on the middleware level, where not everything can be brought into single sign-on. And the best practice here is to put proxy in between your users and the applications or middleware components, often referred to as a PAM. PAM solutions used to be very expensive, but today even open source solutions like Apache Guacamole do the job just fine. So you put those in between your users and your applications or middlewares to basically hold on to the individual credentials per application or middleware while allowing each user to log in with their, for instance, Active Directory credentials. Once all your identities are centralized, your main concern becomes users choosing bad credentials or giving them up through social engineering, which is a topic for another day. On the technical side, central identity management is the way to go. The fourth baseline process, vulnerability management, which really should be called the quality assurance on the first three baseline processes, patching, hardening, identity management, because the main goal of vulnerability management is not to manage vulnerabilities, but to find issues with those first three processes. If the first three processes work well, you don't have any missing patches, all your settings are perfect, and all your identities are strong and have strong credentials. Now, that perfect world doesn't exist. Hence, vulnerability management is there to find remaining gaps in those processes and to steer those processes to be more effective and to have full coverage in your systems. Starting on vulnerability management is relatively easy. You want to run any of the standard scanners, both across the network as well as through an authenticated mode. If you already have a central identity management system, that's easiest done by just giving one of those identities to the scanner. Otherwise, you'll have to fiddle with individual accounts for individual systems. So that gives you scan results, but it often gives you too many scan results. So the art of vulnerability management is to decide what to focus on, to prioritize. We go deeper into this topic in another video. For the moment, just important to note, not everything that a vulnerability manager points out needs to be fixed. It's rather the broad strokes that you need to follow in, for instance, focusing your hardening on a new technology you haven't covered yet, focusing your patching on systems that somehow slipped through your automated patch procedures, and focusing your identity management on identities that are not centrally managed yet. The fifth and final security baseline process, backup and recovery. Through ransomware, we understand that being able to retrieve our data after it's been deleted from production system is very important. However, most backup systems that we come across are not actually ransomware resistant, because they back up too little and they don't pay enough attention to recovery. Backing up too little. Often backup systems focus on databases because that's the unique data that nobody else in the world has. However, if all you have backupped is the data, it will take weeks to rebuild your IT after a ransomware attack until you can recover the backup into the newly built databases. You also need to backup all configuration settings that are unique to your environment, so you can quickly recover your entire IT environment should it be deleted. Maersk, the shipping company, has an interesting case study where during the WannaCry NotPetya attack, they lost all of their Active Directory copies but one, and they were able to bootstrap Active Directory from that one remaining live copy. They didn't have any backups, and had that one copy also been lost, recovery would have taken a lot longer. So make sure to always include your individual configuration settings in the backup, otherwise recovery will take forever. Secondly, and equally important for ransomware-proof backups, make sure you have an easy-to-bootstrap recovery infrastructure. Backups are worthless until you can deploy them into live systems. In order to recover backups, you need working networks, servers, identity management, and a lot more, all of which can be destroyed by ransomware. So make sure that you have a disaster recovery plan to quickly bootstrap a network, a server infrastructure, identity management, everything that's necessary to recover from your backups. And then rehearse that plan, really try it at least once a year. And that should give you relatively high resilience to ransomware, even in cases where the ransomware crew goes after your backup systems and tries to destroy your capability to recover from backups. These were the five baseline security processes, which after a bit of practice should run like a well-oiled machinery. We have individual videos on each of those five topics to dive a little bit deeper. We also have videos on the more advanced topics, security awareness and threat monitoring. Those will never run like a well-oiled machinery. There's always an uphill struggle, really the cat and mouse, spy versus spy that you're fighting with the hackers, which to me anyway makes them more interesting. Looking forward to discuss any of those topics with you in the comments below. And until then, happy hacking.